First time.
You knew your heart.
Someday, somewhere, I'll make a difference.
It's a mockery.
I mean, we're not some deep space franchise. This station is about something.
The year is 2023. The name of the podcast, Babylon 5, for the first time.
Welcome to Babylon 5 for the first time, not a Star Trek podcast. My name is Jeff Akin, and I am watching Babylon 5 for the first time.
And I'm Brent Allen, and I'm also watching Babylon 5 for the very first time. Jeff and I are two veteran Star Trek podcasters who are watching Babylon 5, well, you guessed it, for the first time. And in doing this, we are using that analytical lens we've acquired as Star Trek podcasters to lord over our moral superiority over all things sci-fi and search for the Star Trek-like messages that are in this series and trying to decide how much we really liked it.
And to keep us honest on the Star Trek front, we play a game called the Rule of Three. That means each one of us get up to and no more than three references to Star Trek during the episode.
That's it. Three.
Uno, dos, tres.
No substitutions, exchanges, or refunds.
Brent.
Jeff.
We have a five-star review.
Oh, yes.
This is from Apple Podcasts, and I'm going to say his name incorrectly, but it's Adam Paz. And he says, it's my favorite podcast. I'm a B5 vet, but it's been a blast rewatching B5 week to week with these guys and experiencing it through their eyes. With their encyclopedic knowledge of Star Trek, they bring a great perspective on the show. It's clear they're putting a ton of work into the show, watching episodes multiple times, taking detailed notes, etc. I'm also impressed by the willpower it must take to not skip ahead and binge the show.
Well, I have some news for you. It is incredibly hard.
Oh, I was like, did you cheat? Dude,
I have not. It is incredibly hard to not skip ahead and binge through this show. You know when the worst time was, though, Jeff? Was back kind of like during the Christmas holidays.
Mm-hmm.
Like we bunched a couple up there and bunched back because we have families that we need to spend. And so we had like a period of like a week and a half, maybe 2 weeks, where we didn't record. You remember that? And it was like, oh my gosh, I just want to watch and find out what happens next.
All I have to do is hit play. That's all I have to do. Brent would never even know. It's fine. You'd know.
I could fake it the entire way.
I'm not going to bite. I'm not going to bite on that one. Hey, I've got another comment. This one's from YouTube from a while ago, but it was great. And I don't know. I feel like a very meme-worthy comment as well, if anyone out there wants to put it together. David Brown on YouTube says, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Statler and Waldorf watch Babylon 5 for the first time.
Statler and Waldorf?
Yeah. The old dudes on the Muppets?
The two guys up in the balcony?
Yep. Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I feel like there's a, I don't know, I felt like maybe we should be offended, but also, yeah, that sounds about right.
Statler and Waldorf. I have been compared to a lot of Muppets in my life, Jeff. Statler and Waldorf have never been one, though.
Check that off the list.
There we go. Bucket list complete. I don't know if I should be grateful or if I should be offended.
I know.
I'm gonna have an attitude of gratitude, Jeff. Attitude of gratitude. That's what I'm going to have.
People, and you're part of the country and you rhyme it all together, right?
That's right.
What you do.
That's right. That's what we do. Well, Jeff, along with hearing from our good friends out there and along with the rule of three, we love our segments. We love doing the different things besides just talking about the episode, although we do talk about the episode as well. One of those things that we do is when we get to the end of each episode, we look ahead at the next week's episode and we only look at the title. We don't see anything else but the title. We haven't read descriptions. We haven't looked at thumbnails or anything like that. And we make a prediction just based on the title alone, what next week's episode is. And this is the part right here, Jeff, where it's time to pay the piper and see how right or wrong we were for what we said Passing Through Gethsemane was going to be about. So, Jeff, what did you say this episode was going to be about, and how close were you?
Well, if I only took the first sentence of my guess, I was dead on. I just said, someone's about to go through agony. Yeah, that's pretty true. Also, that could be a lot. That could be most Babylon five episodes, so I don't think it counts. I thought that this was going to be the beginning of a trial for Sheridan. You know, Jesus was arrested in Gethsemane and everything went down from there. And I thought that this was going to be kind of the start of that storyline for Sheridan. It was not that. What about you? What did you guess this one was going to be?
Kind of along the same lines as you did, Jeff. I said that this would be Sheridan and Delenn because there's something about those two being connected. We saw that with, what was that episode at the end of season two?
The Inquisitor one, right?
That one comes the Inquisitor. There's something about them being connected and making a prediction that by the end of the whole thing, they're going to have to sacrifice themselves for the greater good. And this would be the episode where like they find that out and they've got to come to terms with it as far as not far, as far as whether or not they want to be that or not be that. And, like you, I was completely wrong.
Yeah. For an episode that's title really just kind of hands you what it's about. We swung and we missed, but that's okay. But Brent, for the people that it might've been a while since they've watched this, or they haven't watched at all and are listening to us anyway, which is awesome. Hi, people that aren't watching, but listening anyway, Brent, why don't you tell us about Passing Through Gethsemane?
Well, hey, do you remember those monks that came on board the station a few episodes back? Well, guess what? They're still here. And Brother Theo, formerly known as Draw, is playing a game of chess with Captain Sheridan. Looking on are Ivanova and Brother Edward, a.k.a. Brad Dourif, a.k.a. Chucky, a.k.a. Juan Suter. So buckle in, because this is totally going to be a horror episode, right? Brother Edward is a friendly enough chap. He makes trinkets out of some sort of plastic or crystal or rock or something of that nature. We really don't know what. But the point is that much to the financial chagrin of the order, he refuses to sell them, saying he gets double the blessing in making them and then in giving them away. But not to worry, Brother Edward is also aware that the order needs cash to fulfill their greatest purpose of all, which is learning from all the other alien species out there what they call God. So he sets up a deal with someone whom we've never seen before and will likely never ever see again that will do just that. He's all smiles until a black rose appears to have fallen out of his bag, a black rose that he doesn't remember at all. And speaking of not remembering at all, there's a cutscene that explains to us exactly what's going on here. It's Delenn and Garibaldi talking. She wants to know more about this death of personality punishment thing that we last saw back in the season one episode, Quality of Mercy. Basically, it's a punishment in lieu of execution for murderers, whereby their entire personality and all of their memories are erased, and they're released back into society to serve and do good deeds. So is everyone caught up? Everyone understand what's going to happen with Brother Edward now? Because they just told you. All right, let's get back to it. Along with the Black Rose, Brother Edward returns to his quarters where he sees a message written on the wall in blood. Death walks among you. This freaks him out so much that he runs to get Garibaldi, and by the time they get back, there's nothing on the wall. Later, he's meeting with Delenn and Lanier, and they're having a grand old time discussing religious philosophies when Brother Edward tells them that he has always wondered if he would have the courage to do what Jesus did and stay in the Garden of Gethsemane, knowing that death was coming for him. And would you like a side of fries with your foreshadowing there, Brother Edward? Well, heading back from Delenn's, Brother Edward runs into a centauri, and suddenly he's hearing voices and seeing visions. A woman screams, and a black rose is in her mouth, and there's a flash of green light as she falls, and he's looking over his... Wrong story. Brother Edward asks the computer to cross-check all the images that he saw and heard with the name Charles or Charlie or Chucky, and just a mere 4 hours later, which I'm pretty sure Google would have done that in like 4 seconds, wouldn't you know it? It's him. Brother Edward, formerly Chuck Dexter, the Black Rose Killer, who went through the death of personality punishment. Brother Edward is now all sorts of confused. How can he be forgiven if he doesn't even know what his sins are? How can justice be served if he's just here living his life freely? So he goes to the garden. Okay, not really a garden. It's metaphor. It's just a metaphor. And he waits. He waits for his accusers to come. He waits for death to come. And boy, do they. They're the children, the husbands, the families of all the women he's murdered in his life. And they're here to extract revenge. Except now they've all gotten cold feet, except for one. And he has no problem taking all of their frustrations out on Brother Edward. Well, with the help of Lita Alexander, because, yeah, she's back and in perfect health, I might add, as the new attaché of Ambassador Kosh? She scans that Centauri that Edward bumped into earlier. You see, he's a Centauri telepath, and that clues everyone in to know where Brother Edward is. Brown 42. They all rush down, and there's Brother Edward hung up like he's been crucified. And just as he's about to draw his last breath, Brother Theo grants him his last rites. But no worries. The security team has caught up with the guy responsible for this crime. And before you can say death of personality, he's had the procedure performed on him. By whom? Who knows? And now, this guy who murdered Brother Edward is now known as Brother Malcolm. Sheridan has a real rubber meets road moment here, and he eventually extends his hand in greeting, recognizing that this man is not the same man as before. And Sheridan begins his own process of forgiving. And oh yeah, Lita, she's doing something somewhere in Ambassador Kosh's quarters where he's sucking off her soul or something into his encounter suit, which is probably the only thing that's going to carry over into future episodes, to be honest. Jeff, what did you think of Passing Through Gethsemane?
I loved this episode, and I need to own all my biases about this. So if you're listening on the audio version of this podcast, I am wearing a shirt that says Celebrate Diversity, and it has like 16 different crosses and crucifixes on it because of all the different rites of Catholicism. I am an active and practicing Catholic. We've talked about it here on the podcast before, and this was a really beautiful, just like TKO back in season one. You might have heard me mention that one once or twice before, but just like that was such a beautiful examination of one of the practices and traditions in Judaism, this was an ugly and ultimately beautiful examination of one of the mysteries of Catholicism, of forgiveness that we talk a lot about. I loved it. But, you know, not only did this episode have Brad Dourif in it, which is awesome because dude's a legend, but it was directed by Adam Nimoy.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. How cool is that?
We know that guy, don't we?
Yeah. He'd only directed a couple episodes of Star Trek, really, at this point. I think he had something else, but he directed Rascals, which is kind of cool. But yeah, I just thought it was, when I saw his name pop up, I was like, this is awesome. But what I love about it is this episode poses so many of the questions you and I've talked about through this, right? Justice, vengeance, forgiveness, you know, all those things, and how do we balance them? And I think it was done in a really, really entertaining, and in the world of Babylon 5, like a really realistic way. I enjoyed this one a lot. What did you think of it?
I, like with TKO, very much enjoyed this because of the questions that it asks, the ideas that it puts out there. Was it, if you take it for an hour of television and go, was this a fantastic hour of television? Is this, if anybody's just coming along, they sit down and they watch this episode and they're going, yeah, okay, whatever. Are they going to get it? Are they going to latch onto it? I don't know. I really don't. I my guess is no. Kind of like TKO. Like if you look at just TKO, like on the surface, it's really not that great of an episode. I know you would disagree with me, Jeff.
But I am the one.
I'm going to say, right, because every episode is somebody's favorite, and that just happens to be yours. And you are the one. but on the surface, TKO is not that great of an episode. But when you get below the surface and you really dig out the depths of what that episode is about, and you see just the artistry with which the way the episode is put together, it's really a well done episode. And I feel like this is one of those kind of episodes that is, and this one hits a lot closer to me as well. I'm not a practicing Catholic, but this certainly, I'm also not Jewish, so I had to learn a little bit about that. But this one hits a lot closer to me personally in my own faith journey as well. I mean, to see Brad Dourif, when you do that, you know, it's about to be a horror episode.
Totally.
Because there are several people who are typecast out there, and Brad Dourif is one of them. I've never seen Brad Dourif not play the same guy ever. Like, this is always who he is, right? And he does it so good. He does it so, so good.
Yeah, first time I saw him was in David Lynch's Dune back in 84, where he was Peter DeVries, and just, I mean, owned that role. He was, because he's just, that character is creepy and gross and weird and terrifying. And here's Brad Dourif. There you go. Like, it's perfect match.
And then, I mean, even you go all the way to like Lord of the Rings.
Yeah.
Where he is in Lord of the Rings. He's that same slimy, schmarmy, you know, he's a bad guy, but he has a conscience, you know, like Like, what's that all about?
You even see that in Child's Play with the progression of Chucky. Yeah, he's this serial killer and he's horrible, but also like he loves his wife and is willing to kill to bring her back to life as a doll.
Right.
You know, but yeah, he every character he plays has complexity to them, and that's just what he does.
I will say I had one huge, huge disappointment with this episode though, Jeff.
Okay.
We got to see Lita Alexander again.
Mm-hmm.
We did not get to see Evil Talia.
Not even mentioned.
I really wanted to see Evil Talia. And Jeff, I don't know if we're ever going to get to see Evil Talia again. We got, what, a quarter of an episode with Evil Talia? Maybe not even a quarter, like an eighth of an episode with Evil Talia. It was the best Talia I've ever seen. I want more of that Talia.
It's literally just like, oh God, hey, you got any more of that Evil Talia?
Right? Like, come on. Don't give me that? The other one. Give me Evil Talia. Uh-huh. Like, I want that. Yeah, I didn't think we would be seeing Lita again. I don't know why. Did you think we'd be seeing her again? I didn't think she'd come back up.
I didn't think she would. And I didn't, especially not in the way that she came back up. Like,
yeah,
there's some stuff.
But Lita's now it seems like she's going to be a while. She's going to be around a while.
Yeah. I'm going to be here. I'm going to, these things. Also, I'm going to back and forth to Vorlon space because I'm part of his encounter suit.
Okay. Yeah. Can we talk about that and just get that out of the way?
Yeah.
What was that going on? What was your take on that whole thing at the end?
So I have a big theory on this one, and I'm excited about it because I brought it up. I don't remember if it was the end of season two or Matters of Honor at the top of season three. I don't remember where it was, but we were asking about what do the shadows want with human? It must have been Matters of Honor because it was, what do the shadows want with humanity? You know, they're on Earth doing this. And yeah, it was, because it was when they were talking about, Psycor was talking about the Psycop was talking about their program. Well, what program? Well, because the shadows can somehow match with humans. And I asked the question, how do they reproduce? Do they need some like other species? I think that Kosh is reproducing with Lita.
Really?
Lita's going to be a Vorlon mommy.
So did we just see them having sex?
I don't know.
Did we just see full unedited, like, Qs having sex, fully unedited, uncensored on screen?
Stand by. We'll be right back. Are you ready to take your Babylon 5 for the first time experience to the next level? With our exclusive Patreon, you'll get access to all kinds of cool stuff that you can only find there. Our recording notes, unedited reaction videos, an exclusive Discord community, and you can even be listed as a producer of the show. Plus, we even offer exclusive meet and greets and hangouts. You won't find this kind of experience anywhere else. Get all these amazing benefits, plus the opportunity to interact with other fans from around the world. It's being part of a huge community where everyone shares the same appreciation for Babylon 5. Subscribe at patreon.com/Babylon5first. That's the number 5 in the word first, to get access to these incredible benefits. That's patreon.com/Babylon5first. We can't wait to see you there. I think we did. And it was so intense. It gave her gills. Like, it blew her neck out. It was like, that was wild stuff going on.
That's not, you owe me a buzzer, by the way. That's two for me.
I do? I do, don't I?
Yeah. Well, I could have let that go. You wouldn't even know.
I wouldn't have even picked up. I was so just like, oh my gosh, that was such a wild and frankly out of nowhere scene. Like, it's just like, oh, okay, she's in Kosh, you're good. What is happening?
So something that happens in sci-fi that I've seen in at least a couple of places. I don't want to drop a whole lot of names just for future sake, but where aliens either pose as or play the role of the gods and goddesses of humanity's past.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. And even to today. And what you find is, and it's a rather common trope, I feel, that the reason that they're doing that is because somehow they feed off of our worship. Like, our worship feeds them somehow. And the only way that we will continue to do that is if we stay subjected and we stay ignorant. And so they have to continue to oppress humanity so that we realize, hey, these aren't just aliens. These are actual, we don't realize, hey, they're not gods. They're actually just aliens. I can stop worshiping them.
we keep them in that position of power.
Yeah. Yeah. So they've got to keep us pressed down in order to do that. And that's what immediately came to mind. Only this is a very willing participant that knows full well what's going on. And so it seemed like to me, like she was feeding him, like,
oh, wow,
life force getting sucked off or whatever, you know, because Kosh clearly is every person's God out there or something of that nature. I can't imagine that Kosh himself is everybody's God.
Right.
I wonder if that's just a thing of the Vorlon in particular, you know?
But yeah, when you're right, because in that scene, like it was like the light was going into the encounter suit.
Right.
Like, from Leda into it.
Right.
Yeah, maybe.
Right. But I mean, they can still be reproducing if whatever was going from Leda into the encounter suit to make Kosh pregnant.
Yeah, maybe it goes that way.
Kosh is pregnant now.
Right. He's a seahorse. It's the it's just literally someone refusing to say they were wrong when they were gendering the seahorse. But the scene right before that, she and Ivanova were like, she'd left for a while and came back from a trip. And I'm guessing like there was a really subtle break in time between, hey, this dude just killed Brother Edward and then he came back as Brother Malcolm. Right. And then that gap, Leda had some trip and came back. They were, she and Ivanova were walking back. And to my Rush fans out there, they were from at the sign that said gates 12 to 21. Uh-huh. Which is their great record 21-12 the other way. So I'm totally going to say JMS dropped that in as a Rush Easter egg, but she looked very sick. Like she looked pale and she looked like
Leda black. Did you mean
Leda did? Yeah, yeah. Like under her eyes were kind of blackened. And at first I thought like, oh, maybe there's just some weird lighting or makeup mess up or something like that. But now like we're thinking about it, I wonder if there is some, now she's like somehow dependent on the Vorlons for life. Like Franklin was talking about how she's in perfect health.
Yeah.
And so she was gone for a while. And so like she missed out on her Vorlon light party.
I mean that's another thing that you see sometimes in sci-fi, that the trade-off for humanity is they get perfect health mm-hmm. and healing. And, you know, maybe you're an incubator of that God's children or something. That was to everybody out there who knows what I'm talking about that you have no clue, Jeff.
I was just thinking Zeus, right? Like that's the whole like
exactly. Hey. That's exactly what I'm talking about. Yeah. Yeah,
I'm sure it is.
Sure. So yeah. So Leda, very interesting. I want to point this out though before we go any further though, Jeff. Unless did you have anything else about Leda?
Not really.
Okay. Can I also say this about Leda? I'm so glad that Franklin didn't kiss her in the med bay.
Right.
Or med lab. Because he totally looked like he was getting ready to.
It's like, thank you for being appropriate as a medical professional.
Right. Although I assumed that had actually more to do with framing the shot.
Probably
did with natural distances.
I feel like we talked about a while ago, like trying to keep a Marcus count going on, like how often Marcus shows up. We should also have a count of the times Franklin didn't behave inappropriately with a patient. And so far, I think we'd have one.
This one was okay. I'm good with this one.
Yeah.
I did want to point this out. You mentioned Adam Nimoy as the director.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Do you realize that all four of these first episodes of season 3 have all been written by JMS?
Wow, you're right.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we always talk about like he saves the big ones for himself, right? Like they've all been written by JMS, which just goes to tell you, I think it at least has an implication that these episodes are super important.
Mm-hmm.
But in speaking of that, I want to, if we can, I want to jump to the conversation that Delenn and Lanier and Brother Edward were having in their quarters. And I don't remember exactly what all there was, something about the soul and a light being cast onto a wall and mm-hmm. souls are like that. This is only the vessel that you can see to look at it. And there was all this stuff. And that whole conversation to me felt like what I can only imagine is like JMS's own internal dialogue, grappling with belief and faith. Like that's what it felt like to me. It felt like an internal dialogue of like, okay, well there's this, and then there's this, and there's this, and just kind of having a conversation as best as you understand it. And from what I understand about JMS's past, and I know he's an avowed atheist, and something has to do with his past of coming out of other stuff. Like there still has to be thoughts and ideas. And I don't think that you can write a show as religiously heavy as Babylon 5 is without having that as a background, at least somewhere, without having that as a part of who you are as a person. Right. I don't know if that rung out to you at all. It just, and I'm not saying that it was, I'm just saying it had that ring to it to me that like, I felt like we were just peering into JMS's mind for a conversation he's had with himself many, many times before.
Almost maybe like George Lucas in The Force. Like that was when I think, yeah, it was in A New Hope when Ben Kenobi on the Millennium Falcon is like, it's the, you know, it binds us and connects us. And it's this energy. That was George Lucas, like using the Force as his expression of what his belief was, that maybe this whole, like his grappling is not so much that there's a great deity and we worship the deity, is more of just, hey, there's the universe and we're all a part of this universe and we're just physical manifestations of it. I actually like the way, I think it was Delenn who explained it, where it's the universe trying to figure out who it is through its physical manifestations. So we're all just growth journeys of the universe.
Yeah.
I could see, I didn't catch that in there, but I can totally see it. It makes sense.
I think when you just understand who he is and where he's coming from to where he is at the, even at the point of this writing, as best as you and I can understand a dude 30 years ago that we've never met or even heard of really before.
A couple of
six months ago. Not, how long has it been? It's been more than six. Are we at a year yet?
Because we first episode, I think, came out May of last year.
Oh, gosh, we are.
May of 22. Yeah.
We're right there. Yeah. Wow. Jeff.
Time, man. Time goes.
Right.
The other thing I caught out of that whole thing was Lanier started to say more and Delenn cut him off. And I like, he was, you know, well, Valen, something like was not, he said something was not born of Minbari, but and then she shut him up.
A Minbari not born of Minbar.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
He came from nowhere and set up the Grey Council.
And now, according to Jeff, his soul resides in Sinclair.
You think it's, you still think it's Sinclair?
Not totally. Yeah, no reason to think. I mean, they had, he's been on the show once for like 14 seconds. So, I mean, sure, he's still, I'm sure he's going to come back as Valen. Although it's getting less and less likely as the show goes on. But I'm going to hold on to that. I got that. And I've got Anna that I am holding on to. Anna coming back as Morden.
I still think you're full of it. But I did have a theory that I think we can take the red yarn off the board and just completely wipe away. I said a couple episodes ago that that telepaths are born of the Minbari soul.
Mm-hmm.
And given the fact that we have Centauri telepaths, and we did hear from Jakar back in like the first episode that like everybody's got telepaths except for the Narn. So
yeah. And he had ideas on how to fix that, but
yeah, well,
you know. Lita shut him down.
What did you think of Edward? We first saw him. It's Brad Dourif. Oh my gosh. You get over that point. He starts talking. Go.
You can't not help but wait for the moment where he's a psychopath. You know, like what, he makes little origami things and they're cute and he wants this stuff and everything. And you're just waiting for like him to go back to his room and just have like horrifying paintings or buckets of blood or something just like, you know, awful. I mean, we kind of got that, but not in the form of Brother Edward. But it definitely painted everything. I just kept waiting for the other shoe to drop with him. I couldn't buy him as like a truly devout monk until we knew the truth about him. And then I was able to. To jump way ahead, I love that his name was Charles Dexter, because I mean, this was out just at the time of Child's Play. And
is that a reference to Child's Play, to Chucky, if they just call him Charles? It's got to be, right?
Has to be. It was high horror, you know, around this time. Yeah, sure. That was good. That was good slasher stuff that was coming out. Yeah. But no, I loved it. And ultimately, before even talking about Edward, I just asked myself, like, why was he telling this story in Babylon 5? Like taking a lot of this episode to, you know, all the Leda stuff that we will see. That's ongoing stuff. And the things we learned about the Minbari, that was like 5 minutes of the episode. Everything else was around Brother Edward.
Was it even 5 minutes?
I don't even know if it was 5 minutes. I mean, it was a blink.
You know, was it 15 seconds? I don't think it was that long.
It wasn't.
I that's a question I have coming out of this episode as a whole, is why this episode? Is this a filler episode? You got 22 you got to get out. There's a little something you want us to catch out of it, so you put it in the middle of this. But, you know, I said down at the end, this episode feels more preachy than it does storytelling.
Big time.
To me.
Especially knowing it came from JMS to just hit so hard. I mean, this hit so hard over the head. Like this, as a Catholic, one of the things I hear all the time from people, there's a lot of things people grossly misunderstand about our faith and tradition. But one of the big ones is like, So you can just kill somebody and tell a priest you did it and then you're forgiven? I mean, that's ridiculous. That's the dumbest thing. Yeah, that is dumb and ridiculous because that's not how it works. Like, it's deep and it's complex what goes into that reconciliation.
Right.
This was such a deep dive into that one singular mystery of Catholicism. But I think I think it was JMS's way of presenting us, like, his other deep dive into modern faith or contemporary faith was Ivanova and TKO. And that was character development, right? That was giving us more about an important character in Babylon 5. Brother Edward, not an important character ongoing for Babylon 5. So why? I think this is literally.
I'm going to make a guess. Just a prediction right here, Jeff. We're never going to see him again.
You think? Really? I don't know. Maybe he comes back as a space zombie, like dude from the Bureau.
He's a component.
Uh-huh.
He's a
component. Yeah. He's one of them. But I think this was just to introduce the concept of forgiveness. You know, I think that's something that has come up in Babylon 5 a couple of times. And yeah, I don't know. I mean, I could go on and on about all kinds of stuff. So I want to hear what you thought.
Yeah. The pieces that really stuck, the story's the story.
Mm-hmm.
Right. The pieces that really stuck out to me are the questions that it poses, questions that Lon Suter asked. I'm sorry. Brother Edward asked, do you have to know what your sins are in order to have them forgiven?
You don't.
Right. Brother Zio says, no, you really don't. Because God's big. He says, God's big enough that he can take care of the sins that you don't even know. And I'm just sitting here and I'm going, that's so true. That's like, that's so in line with what the Christian faith, the Catholic faith really teaches. I remember an old VeggieTales, God's bigger than the boogeyman. Like, he's so big. Like he can know what all that stuff is. It's not about atoning for each individual thing as much as it is about the deal as a whole, the sin nature as a whole, right? The concept that for Brother Edward, that he says, how can justice be served if I'm just here living? Wasn't justice served with the mind wipe?
Yeah,
that's isn't the point justice of it. Being served by him serving community? Like, do we really have to go to the self-flagellation to really show how sorry? Do you really have to just give over your life to show? Because he clearly, at this point, was remorseful.
Mm-hmm. Very.
And I have this note here, Jeff, and I don't know if this is a Brent thought or if this was a thought that came out of the episode. So maybe you can help me with it. And this kind of gets into the Star Trek message stuff.
Okay.
One of the tropes we see in sci-fi, we've seen it we see it in Stargate. We've seen it in Star Trek. We've seen it in Battlestar Galactica. I'm pretty sure we've seen it in, anyway, sci-fi as a whole is a person still guilty and responsible for the actions that happen in a former life, right?
Yeah.
Like are there actions that can be atoned for based on like heinous crimes that can be atoned for based on what you're doing now, right? Or like I said, truly in a former life.
Mm-hmm.
And with this in particular, with the whole mind wipe idea, like talking about like, oh, he's a thoroughly, thoroughly bad person, thoroughly, thoroughly evil person. Isn't the fact that he's now a new person, isn't that the point, right?
Yeah.
Like, isn't it proof that good existed in Chuck Dexter because Brother Edward exists?
And even after knowledge of Chuck Dexter comes out and that mind wipe is falling away, he's still remorseful. He still wants to pay for his crime. And now he's like a blend. He's Dexter.
I would even challenge what you just said there. I don't think the mind wipe's falling away at all. I think it's purely intact. He just knows what happened. He may not be able to remember it, but he understands what happened. And like, there's a bit of like, he can feel guilt that happened with him, but he doesn't feel the guilt because he didn't even know that it happened. Like, he is there something that you're robbing somebody of their own penance, of their own remorsefulness by making them forget that they did wrong in the first place? Like, one of the things that Christianity teaches, Catholicism teaches, is when your sins are forgiven, you don't necessarily stop sinning. You don't necessarily forget what you have done or where you have been. You just live in a new reality of being forgiven, right? Correct me if I'm wrong.
It's all about your relationship with God. And when, you know, the word sin comes from archery and missing. When you miss.
Missing the mark.
Yep, right? It's a sin. Yeah. And so sin, when you miss, it damages your relationship with God. And when you are forgiven, when you go through, in Catholicism, the sacrament of reconciliation, you are repairing, you're righting that relationship with God. Right. But it doesn't mean it never happened, right?
Right.
It just means that you're right with God now, and you may still have to
face the consequences.
Exactly.
Here on earth, right?
Mm-hmm.
You may still have to deal with that. But as far as this connection goes, the upwards connection, you're good. And is there something about taking that away, taking the horizontal relationship, the relationship to other people? If you take that away, that the relationship vertically cannot be mended, or can have a hard time, or even just your own internal relationship. That's where this episode was so intriguing to me. And then when we come down to at the end, when they find him hanging on the cross, I mean, my God, they've got him crucified up there.
Yeah, 100%.
I don't know if you get any more bonk bonk over the head, but he asks this question: is there enough forgiveness for what I've done? And it poses that question: is there a limit to forgiveness? Now, it's easy to say with God, with a figure of faith, forgiveness is unlimited.
Mm-hmm.
But is forgiveness limited between people? Should forgiveness be limited to people? Or rather, let me rephrase that: should between people forgiveness be unlimited? To go back to more Bible, Jesus said, hey, forgive your brother seven times. Some say seven times seven. I say 70 times seven,
mm-hmm.
which is really only 490. But what he was really saying is unlimited amount of times.
Yeah.
You always forgive. Always forgive. And that's something, you know, we practice in my house here. I'm not trying to tell anybody else how to parent out there, but you know, when my kids, especially when they do something to each other, you know, there's the three-step process. I'm sorry that I did this. I'll promise I won't do it again, or I'll try not to do it again. Will you forgive me? Like, we make them say those words. Will you? A lot of times people lose that third one. What's really funny is we've practiced that so long here that when like a friend comes over and it happens, like my oldest will be like, and now ask them to forgive you, because people don't often go through that step of saying the words, will you forgive me? And it's a thing that we model as parents. My wife and I, we model that as parents, and we do that in our own relationship because we're people. But you know what? What's really cool about that is no matter how mad you are at somebody, saying the words, I forgive you, immediately at least begins to break down the oomph of that thing. You know what I mean? Like, it may not be all the way gone. You can actively be like, no, I'm going to hang on to it, which that's a whole different conversation, but that can just melt away.
Yeah, I think that this episode dives into that, and it dives into it through the question of capital punishment. Is a mind wipe, getting death of personality, more humane than the death penalty? Garibaldi and Delenn have that conversation about it, and Garibaldi is an eye for an eye guy, right?
And yeah.
Delenn channels her inner Gandhi and basically says, you know, eye for an eye, the whole world would be blind. But, oh gosh, there's a lot to this, because what happens, so if we follow the tenets of Christianity in the Bible and the Sermon of on the Mount, Jesus gives us the Lord's Prayer. And in there it says, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive others. So
right.
If we expect to enjoy the unlimited forgiveness that God offers, then we have to offer it as well. Now, that's not conditional, right? So I'm dramatically oversimplifying a lot of this, but we have to model what that's like. The point, literally, that's the point of Christian religion and most religions, is it's our job to model what our deity shows us to do. And the key tenet of Christianity is that we forgive others, and that's right. That's what we do. So in the context of the death penalty, right? So someone does bad, and so we kill them. You know, you killed somebody, I'll show you, I'll kill you right back, and we'll see how that goes. So apparently, you know, humanity's moved beyond that. They do death of personality. So what happens here? Brother Edward realizes what he has done, and he wants forgiveness. So he goes to the garden, as you described, and waits for them to show up. And crazy Malcolm, that dude just looks nine ways to wild.
Sure.
He comes out and he's like, yeah, I'm straight gonna murder you. So he does. He kills him. But what happens to him? The same thing. Now his personality has been killed. We have a quote unquote more humane way of meeting out justice, but it's just creating the same cycle that eye for an eye makes the whole world blind does. We're just wiping out personality after personality. So is there forgiveness that's unlimited potential for people. I truly believe that there is an unlimited potential for forgiveness, but we have this barbaric part of us that wants to see people suffer for the bad that they've done. And we internalize that. Edward internalized that. He wanted that to happen to him in a way that he felt would make him right. As you said, make him right horizontally, make him right with people.
Right.
It's just wild to me. You know, could you imagine what if in that moment when Malcolm says, hey, yeah, they're not ready to go, but I'm ready to go. What if one of them stepped forward, put their arms on Malcolm and was like, no, look, Brother Edward, I forgive you.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Jeff, I think we've hit that part of the show where we boil it all down and see if this has any of that Star Trek quality to it. We're already there.
We're doing it.
a part of this is kind of sometimes saying, here's how Star Trek would have done this show versus how Babylon 5 did this show. Okay. Let me start there. You know how Star Trek would have solved this? The exact way you just said.
Exactly.
Yep. Somebody would have forgiven. Babylon 5 said, no, F that. We're going to go the other way, right? But Jeff, let's do this. Let's jump into it. Let's see if there's any of that message. Is there a mirror to society? Is there a moral to it? Are we giving us hope that things can be better in the future, that we can get to be better in the future? And in doing that, Jeff, the way we do this is we rate it on a scale of 0 to 5 deltas. And we also rate it on a scale of 0 to 5 star furies. Deltas being how messagey, how preachy is this episode. Star Furies being how Babylon 5, how not Star Trek is this episode. And I'm going to take deltas on this one. You're going to take Star Furies. I'll go first.
All right.
There's tons to dissect here. And we're already in the thick of it. I mean, we're up to our elbows in frog guts right now, having dissected this thing. What is the nature of forgiveness? I think is really what this episode comes down to. On the part of the sinner, can you forgive yourself? Because that was Brother Edward's thing. Mm-hmm. He couldn't forgive himself once he knew what he had done. And we talked about that. Or do you have to put yourself in the way of crucifixion to pay for your sins? Do you really have to do that? In the end, was it even enough? Because he sits there and he asks Brother Theo at that point. He's like, is this enough? Have I done it? Like, I always wondered if I could stay here, and I did. Is that going to be enough? Is that going to be enough? And Brother Theo's like, buddy, you've already been. Like, that's the crazy thing. Before you ever did this, you were forgiven, you know?
In the scene that was a mock confessional, right? Where they're behind the grates and there was the dark lighting going on. And where Brother Edward was just like, I am a horrible person. I'm a murderer. I need this. And Theo was just like, you just ask God for forgiveness. You want forgiveness in your heart. And you have, like, he gave that message there. And then after Edward did everything, he said it again as he was doing a version of the last rites. He's like, no, you've been good all along, man. Like, yeah, it's great courage that you showed, but you've been good for a long time.
You're okay. So there's the part of the sinner. Let's talk about the part of the victim. Can you do forgiveness as being part of the victim? Let's talk about the victim's family. And specifically, we'll talk about the guy that eventually became Brother Malcolm, because I don't think we ever had his pre-mind wipe name.
I don't think so.
Was becoming what you hated worth it? Because he hated Brother Edward. He hated Chuck Dexter. Let's call it what it was. He hated Chuck Dexter so much that he went and became Chuck Dexter. Now, sure, he may not have had a serial killer of all these people with a little token left behind in his wake, but he went and became a murderer. He lost himself in the middle of it because of his inability to forgive. I feel like at this point I should say, just, I have never had somebody that I love be murdered and have to go through the process of forgiving somebody who has murdered a loved one. I can't say for sure that any of our listeners have never gone through that. I don't know. So I don't mean to be talking out of my ear with something like this. The overall message, though, I think is clear.
Yeah. If I could.
Yeah.
I'm gonna share a story. It's not. Okay. So I'm gonna try and stay cool through this. Back in just before Thanksgiving. I don't think I ever talked to you about this, Brent. I haven't talked to a lot of people about this, but just before Thanksgiving, I have a good friend who was brutally murdered. She was an in-home care provider specifically for people with Lou Gehrig's disease. And so she would take care of people. She's a longtime nurse, just an incredible person. And she went to take care of one of her women patients, who was an older woman, and her adult son was there. Her adult son is not a mentally healthy person, attacked her, broke an end table over her head, and she died 9 days later. And it was in a coma, and it was really hard. Went to her funeral. She's Catholic, so it's a Catholic, it's a mass that you do for the Catholic funeral. And at the end, the family, someone can come and eulogize. I got to eulogize her. It was a beautiful eulogy. And at the end of it, they forgave the man who killed her.
Wow.
And they talked about, how in the scripture, it says that there is a time to every purpose. And in that scripture, it says that there is a time to kill, and there is a time to heal, and there is a time to love. And when they forgave, the guy who did this, they said that this was not only the time to kill, but it was to kill her in, because she was doing something that was pure and of love. She was there because she loved this patient of hers and wanted to do well. And so she died doing what she was here to do. And the strength that I'm friends with members of her family to this day, months later, still speak of this perpetrator in terms of, like, there's an ongoing trial that's still happening, and there's stuff, and they're going to be saddled with this for a long time, but they still speak in terms of forgiveness for him. And they have pity on him, you know, because he's not a mentally healthy person. And he was expressing his illness in a way that killed our friend and their sister. But what I know is that every member of that family is healthy.
Yeah.
They're cared for. And I'm going to say that they're okay, but they're not okay. Right. But they're not in a place. They're not in a place where they're not victims, and they don't feel like things that they're going to heal from this. And I have to believe that a huge part of that, because it's for the whole family, like everyone, a lot of it is because they chose to forgive. Despite just horrible, senseless violence, they chose to forgive.
You did not tell me that before this moment. And wow, I am flabbergasted and floored. And that's happened within the life of this show.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. I'm so sorry. Thank you. Jeff, if you don't mind, I have a third part. So I talked about on the part of the perpetrator, the part of the sinner, the part of the victim or the victim's family. I'm going to talk now about the part of the third party observer. Mm. And that might be a little bit more you. So I'm going to talk what I gained from the episode. And I want you to tell me if this rings true.
Okay.
And please feel free to correct anything I'm saying from reality. I'm just going to tell you what I got from the episode. Okay. Speaking of the idea of forgiveness. And in this case, I want to look at Sheridan, specifically Sheridan. Sheridan was very able to forgive Brother Edward for what he had done in his past life, presumably because he'd never known Brother Edward when he was Chuck. He only ever knew him as Brother Edward. So that was his dude. He, I dare say, loved Brother Edward. He was endeared to him. Like, that was his guy. So he can forgive Brother Edward for being Chuck. Can he forgive Brother Malcolm for being who he was and murdering Brother Edward? And also, if you're going to throw the book at the victim's family, you know, the others that were in the garden, so to speak, can you do what they could not? You know, now I don't know that the victim's families forgave Brother Edward as much as they just said, we don't want to kill him now. Mm-hmm. But that one guy said, no, I'm going to do this. Can he forgive, he meaning Sheridan, can he forgive this new man, this now Brother Malcolm, who is not that guy from just a few minutes ago in the episode? Can he forgive him there? And there's this really strong moment where Brother Malcolm extends his hand in greeting to Sheridan, and Sheridan recoils. And he kind of looks at him almost like he knows, but he doesn't. And it took Sheridan a moment. Brother Theo had to say some words to him. And in a real weird, awkward, kind of over the shoulder way, he reached out his hand, which was a huge moment of forgiveness on Sheridan's part. That was like, okay, he could get there. He could be that. That's the Star Trek piece that they may not, but we as humanity, we can get there, right? That forgiveness, can you do what the other people can't? Can you see this new person? You're a third party. You're not in the midst of this. You don't have a dog in this fight. You know, can we look at somebody in another country? Can I look at your situation, Jeff? I have no clue what's going on out there. Can I see this person in that same light? You know, fortunately, and I'm really happy to hear about the family. And I can only imagine how that's for you as a leadership guy, how that's helping to lead you. Mm-hmm. And the other surrounding members of that community that were in her orbit, your friend's orbit. But I think it comes down to this idea. Vengeance will blind you. Rage will blind you. And truthfully, only forgiveness can free you. Sheridan says this great line, where does vengeance end and justice begin? And that's a whole different thing that I'm not going to go into. I said earlier, I felt like this episode was more preachy than it was anything. And that to me is the essence of a Star Trek message. I think this is a 5 Delta Star Trek episode through and through.
Yeah, I totally agree. And you're right, because I think as the third party observer, watching the people adjacent to the horror be able to give forgiveness, it almost like what Brother Theo said, like he very sternly said to Sheridan, right? Forgiveness is a hard thing, but something ever to strive for. When you see someone who's been impacted more than you by a thing be able to do that, it kind of calls you on that. Like, who am I to not, you know, also extend this? And it does. It helps to heal. What it does for that third party impacted person, I'm not focused on the dude who did this horrible thing. I'm focused on my friend, you know, and like remembering great things we did together and hoping as a Catholic, you know, for her in a great place. It does that. It allows healing. And I think what I love and totally agree with your 5 Delta rating is part of what started Star Trek, the philosophy, Gene Roddenberry's philosophy of Star Trek was we've outgrown religion. You know, we're beyond the need for that mythology and whatever.
Yeah.
Star Trek is super religious, right? Not just Judeo-Catholic, but even Islam and Hindu and other religions who at their core tell you, just be a good person and help the people around you. Like if you boil down, I'll say 98% of active religions out there, that's the core message. Just be cool, man. Like just be cool. The rules change very per religion, but that's the message of Star Trek as well. So for Star Trek who is anti-religion straight out and, you know, tries to make no bones about it, but it's totally religious. And then Babylon 5, written by an avowed atheist in a way who's using religion as a way to impart these messages. I just love how religious they are, even though they're not. It's great. Totally agree. 5 Deltas.
One of the things I love, Jeff, is for a guy who is a sci-fi writer, a guy who, despite our own debates here, I think he clearly believes he was ripped off, and as do a lot of our listeners out there, and that's all okay. He can still go out and write something that feels very Star Trek-y at its core. And it's not, it's him. Like it's him through and through coming out. Like that whole conversation to me, like I said, was his own internal dialogue earlier today. And I love that he can still go out and do it his way. Jeff, what did you think as far as Star Furies go?
I totally want to give this 5 Star Furies. I'm not going to, I want to, but a lot of that's because of me, my background and how I saw this. And I am a professional enough analyst and podcaster of things to say, I'm going to acknowledge my bias and set it aside a little bit. This was like we just talked about. I mean, just such a deep and rich exploration of forgiveness. We learned a lot more about the Minbari and their belief system. And then the Leeta Kosh stuff, like how cool is that? But you said it at one point earlier, and I can't not get past it. This is a lot, and a lot of rich conversation we could have. But as far as like an episode of television, is this good? Is this enjoyable? It's okay. It's okay. It took a Star Trek message and did it in a very Babylon 5 way. So I am, based on that, the giving it in a very Babylon 5 way, I'm going to give this one 4 Star Furies.
Fair enough. I can't argue with that. If you would have given it 5, I would not have argued with it. And I'm not really allowed to, honestly.
Right, exactly. You got to take it. Well, you get ready to take it, because this next section, you don't get to argue with me either.
Well, absolutely not, because just like last season, we are creating the absolute 100% completely accurate definitive ranking of the third season of Babylon 5. So, Jeff, where do you put Passing Through Gethsemane? Our current ranking is 1, Matters of Honor. 2, A Day in the Strife. And 3, Convictions.
These are all great. Season 3 has had a really good start to it. These are all really good episodes, and they're all really interesting. I recently listened to our episode on Matters of Honor again, because sometimes I listen to our episodes. I enjoy our show. It's a
game film.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Well,
you know what I always say, Jeff, the mantra that we have, figure out what show you would want to listen to and then make that show.
Make that show. Exactly. But I went back and listened to it, and it was a great episode. It was really good. I don't think any of the episodes so far have given us just the richness of this one. Brent, I am going to call Passing Through Gethsemane our new number one episode.
Wow. All right. Well, I'm allowed to comment on it one way or the other, or at least countermand you. And I'm not sure that I would disagree with you.
Well, Brett, that's it for Passing Through Gethsemane. Next week, we like to play this game. If you're new to us, welcome. Hi. We like to play games here on Babylon 5 for the first time. And we like to play this game where we guess what the next episode is going to be based only on the title. We don't look at thumbnails. We don't look at anything. Next week, we're going to be watching the episode called Voices of Authority. So, Brent, what do you think Voices of Authority is going to be about?
Is this a Linkin Park music video?
Wow.
They had a song, Voices of Authority. Oh, no, Points of Authority.
That's Points. Yep.
Points of Authority. Voices of Authority. So this is the making of a Linkin Park music video, but it's like Linkin Park's great-great-grandchildren. No. Let's see here. This feels like, so Authority, I think we're getting back to Earth. President Clark. Maybe that chick that we saw with Morden. The Senate chick or whatever she was, mm-hmm. right? Yeah, I think what's maybe going to happen is they're going to be sending conflicting orders to Babylon 5. They're sending orders that Sheridan just doesn't want to go through on. Like maybe that Ministry of Peace thing is amping up, is back again, you know, something like that. We might even get to see General Haig resurface. That'd be cool. I want to know more of what's going on with him. There's this whole like movement that Sheridan's just a part of. I want to hear about what else is going on out there with old General Haig and the rest of the people out there fighting against President Clark. How about you, Jeff?
Well, you know who has a lot of authority right now in the world of Babylon 5?
Londo.
Yep, the Centauri.
Ooh,
totally. Okay. But Centauri have a lot of authority. Londo does not anymore. So I think that this is going to be a shot from Lord Rifa and the Emperor with Cartagia and kind of that crew that's still in. They're still in with Morden and whatever. Uh-huh. They're going to do something that really kind of puts Londo in his place a little bit. Checks that ego. Reminds him that now he's just the ambassador on Babylon 5. And I guess we're going to find out right here next week. Thank you all so much for listening to our dissertation on Christianity and modern religions through the lens of Babylon 5. Appreciate it very much. But honestly, thank you so much for joining us every week. It means so much to us. If you haven't already, please subscribe wherever you're listening to us. If you're on YouTube, do the same. And stop by Apple Podcasts or Good Pods, Podchaser, wherever. Audible is a great one as well. To go on and leave us a rating or review, we'll read it right here on the podcast. But until next time.
Hey, Jeff.
Yeah. Yeah, Brent.
You want to see my life gills?
No.
Give me some of my energy?
Yeah, not even if you fried every synapse that I've got. Peace, victory, and long life.
It's my first time.